Perot included evaluating policy options and briefing White House and federal agency officials on policy recommendations with regard to the uninsured, Medicaid, and CHIP. So I am pleased beyond words to have Chiquita Lewis Ashour be present tonight.
Thank you all for inviting
There's always a broken microphone. So, Administrator Brooks-LaSure, recently there was a lot of news about Medicare's decision not to cover the Alzheimer's drug Aduhelm except in clinical trials. And, you know, this was a disappointment for people who saw it as their best home for treatment and relief to people who thought that it really wasn't worth the cost and didn't have demonstrated benefits. So my question for you is this, will we see more of this? Do you think CMS will be doing these coverage determinations more frequently, and will drug makers have to pass muster with the FDA and then the CMS? What do you see? What do you
try to give them clarity about the flexibility that they have. So we are encouraging states as they're doing what we call redetermination, so finding out whether people are eligible for Medicaid, that they do that in a transitional way, in the sense of not trying to process so many claims, so many enrollments immediately, and also trying to make sure we're linking them to coverage. Again, if their incomes have gone up, that we get them into the marketplace. I would say we're also trying to work with other partners, like health plans, providers, and other organizations to make sure we hold on to this coverage.
Great. All right, we have a lot of questions. Let's start over here. Please say who you are and who you are for.
Hi. I'm Liz Seeger, I'm an independent journalist, and I cover aging for the association. I wanted to ask you about a new report that recently came out from the National Academies on nursing home quality and care. It was a 600-page report that made numerous recommendations about transparency, including quality, infection control, and so on. We've had other reports like this come out in the past, and they kind of get the rest on the shelves. What does CMS intend to do to actually take on steps to implement some recommendations?
Sure, thank you for the question. As we all know, over the past couple of years, people living in nursing homes have experienced COVID-19, the negative effects. Most acutely, and we have been very focused over the last year in really engaging. I personally spent, as head of our leadership team, time talking with staff, certified nursing assistants, nurses, with residents themselves, with other people, women and men who serve, as well as the industry. And out of those discussions and a real concern about what we're seeing in terms of quality and safety came the president's charge for us as CMS to really engage on a variety of fronts. And so we have put out really a blueprint of some of the policies that we intend to take. The most significant one, and one that is getting quite a lot of attention, is nursing home staffing. That is something that we have committed to propose a standard next year, and it's one that we are really wanting to engage and already hearing how much this is a part of quality. But and we are also doing more in terms of transparency. So we are adding more information on nursing home compare so that families and caregivers can know what staffing turnover looks like. We are publishing last week. Released more information about nursing home ownership, because one of the things that we've heard are families feeling like we don't even know who to talk to. But this is only part of what we are approaching. Last week I was with Illinois officials and really trying to, have been engaging on nursing home staffing and other quality issues. And we really want to work with states to make sure it's both sides, what we're doing on the Medicare side and our oversight, as well as Medicaid, and really trying to make sure that we're paying for direct care, care for people, making sure that we are encouraging things related to staffing, which, while part of that is pay, are numerous other issues like career ladders and other things.
It's nearly impossible to get someone with late-stage dementia into hospice care from the Medicare program. It's something I've experienced as a caregiver and something I've worked about. And I just wondered, in the past couple of years, there's been no action on this. I wonder if in the future Medicare is going to be more inclusive about people with dementia and hospice care.
I can't say specifically on what
definition of maternal mortality in the U.S. changed in 2006, but that was up to the states to adopt the new changes, and they didn't do it until 2013. But we're using data comparing death rates, maternal mortality, 10 years ago versus today, or 20 years ago versus today, and the data is being counted very differently. So my question is, what can you do in your agency to sort of rationalize this data to find where the trouble spots actually are?
Services that are what I would call health adjacent, right next to them. And I'll give a specific example. what we're collecting in terms of race and ethnicity data. And on COVID in particular, we've been trying to put out a lot of information around who's been affected and what have you.
Hi, thank you so much for doing this. That was Miranda Olsky with Politico. I wanted to ask, a lot of advocacy groups are looking for more action from CMS on the growing number of states that are looking to restrict and take Planned Parenthood as mother reproductive health
would you tell you? The Senate or the legislatures can stack against them, and every solution that we seem to come up with is a rule violation. What would you tell you to help get this legalized?
So I would say that we'd have to have a longer conversation about all of the pieces. We do, as an agency, care very much about what is happening in our rural areas, about access to care, and we understand and know that there are issues. We have some flexibility, but a lot of our rules are set by the requirements we have in Congress. And so if I were talking to a particular hospital, you know, we would look at what is happening with them, but it may, some of these things may be really talking to Congress. Sometimes it's something we can do, but often it is really trying to make sure that the representatives understand some of these issues.
It's a zero-based budget. So the richer states, the more congressional members, don't want their hospitals to lose, while the poorer states are continuing to lose and don't have representation to fund it.
There still are ways to, I understand your question, and say they're like really helping to educate, whether it's us when we have authority or whether it's Congress. That's really the way that we make changes and help people pay.
Thank you.
Sorry. So I was never looking at some of the video of KBIA.
We definitely are.